In this video lecture, we'll discuss about the detection techniques that are used for demodulating the received signal via different modulation schemes. So the detection or demodulation technique adopted at the receiver end, that we are going to discuss in this lecture. But before that, we'll have a look at one numerical problem, and after that we'll move on to the detection part. So in the question, we are given with a communication system having few blocks. You are given with a balanced modulator input. To this balanced modulator is XT, and the another input is a high frequency carrier signal of frequency 10 kilohertz. Output of this balanced modulator is given as input to a high pass filter with cutoff frequency 10 kilohertz, and then again we pass it through a balanced modulator with the carrier frequency as 13 kilohertz, and the output is Y of T, and the input signal XT, its corresponding spectrum is given as this. This is frequency in kilohertz, okay. Now the question is to find out the positive frequency where Y of F, the spectrum of YT, Y of F is the spectrum of YT, will have peaks. That means question is to find out the positive frequencies where Y of F will have peaks. Alright, we are given with the input signal spectrum and with peaks at 1 and minus 1 kilohertz. This spectrum is passed through these three blocks, and the output is Y of T. The question is to find out the positive frequencies where Y of F, that is the spectrum of YT, will have peaks. Okay, let us go step by step here. So the X of F, which is the input spectrum, it has peaks at 1 kilohertz and minus 1 kilohertz frequency. So peaks are at 1 kilohertz and minus 1 kilohertz. Right. It is given first as input to a balanced modulator with carrier frequency 10 kilohertz. I hope you remember the functionality of the balanced modulator. It multiplies the input message and the carrier signal to generate a DSBSC type of a signal. So the basic functionality of balanced modulator is to multiply the two incoming signals. So we can say that this output of balanced modulator 1, because there are two balanced modulator used in this system model, the output of two balanced modulator will be XT multiplied by CT. And the carrier frequency of the CT is 10 kilohertz, right? Now, since there is these two signals are getting multiplied, so their corresponding frequencies would be added or subtracted. Okay, let's say the frequency of concern to us is the peak frequency only, because we need to find out the positive frequency where YF will have peaks. So XF has peaks at 1 and minus 1 kilohertz. Now we want to analyze how these peaks are shifted while the signal travel through these three blocks. Okay, we need to track the travel of the peaks, right? So the peak is at 1 kilohertz or minus 1 kilohertz, and this is 10 kilohertz, right? So if you multiply these two signals, XT and CT, their frequencies will get added or subtracted, right? So the output of balance modulator 1 will have peaks at what? On this 10 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz plus minus 1 kilohertz, or 10 kilohertz plus minus minus 1 kilohertz. Right, output of BM1 will have peaks at these frequencies, right? So it will have peaks at 11 kilohertz or 9 kilohertz, or we can say at 9 kilohertz and 11 kilohertz. Okay, so it will have peaks at basically 11 kilohertz and 9 kilohertz. That's okay. Now we pass this output of balance modulator 1 through a high pass filter with cutoff frequency 10 kilohertz. That means this high pass filter will pass the signals having frequency components above 10 kilohertz, and the frequency components below 10 kilohertz will be suppressed. Okay, so the if you look at the output of high pass filter, we are giving a signal as input having peaks at 11 kilohertz and 9 kilohertz. Okay, when you pass it through high pass filter with cutoff frequency 10 kilohertz, obviously the 9 kilohertz peak will be eliminated and the peak will be only left at 11 kilohertz. Right, now this output of high pass filter, if you look analyze here, this output of high pass filter is passed through another balance modulator with carrier frequency 13 kilohertz. Okay, so now the output of balanced modulator 2, which is nothing but your output signal Y of F, will have peaks at your 13 kilohertz plus minus 11 kilohertz. So it will have peaks at 24 kilohertz and 2 kilohertz. So these are the two positive frequency where the output signal YT will have peaks while we analyze the spectrum of those signals. So the peaks will be available at 24 kilohertz and 2 kilohertz. Okay, so now we'll have a look at the detection process. So far we have seen the modulation part of the different modulation schemes, right? So we'll just have a quick revision of what we have done so far, very very quick revision, and then we'll move forward to the detection part. So we have seen that amplitude modulation it has several variants. We have studied three of those variants. The first one is DSBC, or you can say conventional AM. Second one is your DSBSC, and third one is your SSBSC. So in the DSBC or conventional AM type of a modulation system, we know that the modulated signal consists of carrier plus multiplication of message and the carrier signal. Okay, so it has basically three components, the carrier and the two sidebands, which are nothing but represented by multiplication of message and the carrier. On the other hand, double sideband suppressed carrier has only two sidebands, which is equivalent to multiplication of message and carrier. And SSBSC is the signal having only a single sideband, so the carrier is suppressed and one sideband is suppressed, so we are left with only one sideband. So all these modulation activities, these take place at the transmitting end. Okay, we have already studied the need of modulations. Okay, so this all these things are done at the transmitting end. Now once we have the modulated signal that is being transmitted to a distant receiver, okay, so now we have a transmitter and a receiver, a distant receiver. Modulated signal is transmitted, okay, and at the receiver end we receive this modulated signal with some noise. Okay, Now, reverse and the important step at the receiver end is demodulation. We perform modulation at the transmitting end, and its reverse process demodulation takes place at the receiver, that is to retrieve back your message signal from the modulated signal. Because we are receiving modulated signal, so we need to retrieve back the message signal out of that. So that process is known as demodulation. So we have different types of demodulation techniques available with us. So to begin with, we'll discuss now the demodulation techniques. There are two and three most popularly used demodulation techniques. Demodulation, or we also call it as detection of AM signals. So we have envelope detection, very popular technique, envelope detection. Second one is your synchronous detection, or we also call it as coherent detection. And this envelope detection is a type of a asynchronous. It is a type of a asynchronous or a non-coherent or non-coherent type of detection. And the third type of the detection or the demodulation technique is your square law detector. First, we'll have a look at the envelope detection, or which is also a kind of a asynchronous or a non-coherent type of detection technique. It is one of the simplest type of the detection process for amplitude modulated signals. In particularly the conventional amplitude modulated type of a signal. It is used for conventional AM type of signals. These are also known as non-coherent or asynchronous type of the detection process. The reason we call it asynchronous or non-coherent because it does not require carrier signal at the receiver end for the detection. Does not require carrier signal at the receiver for detection. This is the reason we call it non-coherent or asynchronous type of the detection. The reason it does not require the carrier signal is that the carrier signal is already present in the conventional AM type of a signal. This is the reason why this envelope detection type of technique is preferred only for conventional AM type of signal, because it already have the carrier signal in it. The modulated signal already have a carrier component present. Okay. It's a very simple circuit diagram for envelope detector. It consists of just three discrete elements: a diode, a p-n junction diode, a resistor, and a capacitor. This is your envelope detector. It's a very simple and a very cheap kind of a detector, because it consists of very inexpensive, you can say, discrete elements: a diode and a resistor and a capacitor, which are quite cheap. So it's a very simple and a very cheap kind of a detector, right? Let us understand the working of this envelope detector now. The input is your conventionally amplitude modulated signal, right? If you remember the modulated signal, it was something like this. The conventional amplitude modulated signal, it was something like this. This was the kind of the envelope
and this was the signal. Right, so this was your amplitude modulated type of a signal in time domain, right? So when we pass it through, the first step is we pass it through a diode. Diode will act as a switch. So for the positive polarity, it will be forward biased and it will be in the on condition. And for the negative polarity, for it will be in the reverse biased condition, and it will not allow the signal to pass through it. So all the negative polarities will be eliminated, right? So after passing through the diode, the signal available with us will be something like this. This is the envelope. Right, this is the kind of a signal after we pass it through the diode. All right, so the next step is that this is your signal, right? Now we have a RC circuit. Now the charging discharging process will take place. After this step, we pass it through a RC circuit to enable charging and discharging. See, as the name suggests, envelope detector. So what we are basically doing, we are trying to track the envelope of the signal, and we'll be doing that by tracing the signal through charging and the discharging process. So now if you see, the signal starts increasing. If you see, this signal starts increasing till this point, right? So the capacitor will get charged up till this point with the peak voltage, this, right? And after that, you will see that once we are past this point, the capacitor will start discharging through this resistor, right, with a particular discharge constant, time constant, that is your discharging time constant. So the capacitor will start discharging. We'll discuss more on charging and the discharging time constant in detail, but first we need to analyze and understand the working of this circuit, right? So let us assume that the capacitor starts discharging beyond this point, and at this point again the signal is encountered. So again the capacitor will charge till this point, and after this, beyond this point, it will start getting discharged. Again the signal is encountered, charge, it will charge it again, then discharge, charge, discharge, charge, discharge, charge, discharge. So in this way, this charging and discharging phenomenon is allowing us to track the envelope, the peaks of the signal, that is the envelope, okay? So the output of this RC circuit, or you can say charging and discharging, will result into a distorted envelope, you can say, right? Something like this. It will have high frequency ripples present into it. And further, if you pass it through a high pass filter having cutoff frequency, a low pass filter, further it pass it through a low pass filter having cutoff frequency equivalent to frequency of the maximum frequency component present in the message signal, you will analyze that, you will get this kind of a signal, which is your original message signal. So this is how the circuit works to determine the message signal from the modulated, conventionally amplitude modulated signal, right? Now comes the important concept. See, the charging and the discharging time constant plays a very significant role here. So what can we predict about the charging time constant? Charging time constant if you're talking about charging time constant, this is equal to RF into C, where RF is the forward bias resistance, which is pretty small. RF is the forward bias resistance of this diode, and This C is the capacitor. So the charging process takes place through this route, diode and the capacitor, right? So the charging time constant will be RF into C, isn't it? And we say that the charging time constant, it should be low or high, ideally. If you want to track the peaks properly, the charging time constant should be quite low, right? The peak should be achieved as soon as possible to have a proper envelope tracking, right? The charging time constant should be very, very less. All right. So we say that this RFC, that is the charging time constant, it should be much lesser than 1 upon F of C. This is the relationship. FC is the carrier frequency and it's a high frequency, right? So 1 upon FC is a very small time constant, right? So RFC should be lesser than 1 upon FC. All right. Now if we talk about discharging time constant, the discharging time constant, if you look at the path of discharging, the discharging path is this capacitor and the resistor. This is the discharging path, right? The capacitor discharges through the resistor. So the discharging time constant is R into C. Okay, so this R into C, it should be low or high. See, if it is too low, if this discharging time constant is too low, then it will discharge very quickly, right? That means beyond this point, it will discharge very, very quickly. Okay, beyond this point, it will discharge very, very quickly. Before the next positive pulse comes, it gets completely discharged. The capacitor gets completely discharged if the discharging time constant is too low. Okay, in that case, the detected symbol will be highly distorted, isn't it? And if the discharging time constant is too high, the capacitor will not discharge very easily. So it will retain this particular peak voltage for a longer time, right? So it will remain same. It will remain same. Okay. So whenever there is some steep changes, and the discharging time constant is too high, it will not be able to track the envelope properly. So it has both the issues. The discharging time constant, it cannot be too low or too high to properly detect the envelope. Right, so this R into C, that is the discharging time constant, should have a moderate value. What should be the moderate value of this RC? This RC, it should be greater than equal to 1 upon FC, and this RC should be less than equal to 1 upon FM, and this is quite logical. Hence, the range of RC should be in the range of 1 upon FC to 1 upon FM. This is a very, very important relationship to design the envelope detector. The discharging time constant of the envelope detector should lie in this range, 1 upon FC to 1 upon F of M. Okay, the reason of this particular range is the RC should be greater than or equal to 1 upon FC. If RC is not greater than 1 upon FC, in that case the capacitor will discharge completely before the next positive pulse arises, and that will lead to highly distorted envelope detection, right? So hence this RC should have a moderate range, that is it should lie between 1 upon FC to 1 upon FM for proper envelope detection to take place. Okay, so this is the first type of the detector, that is the envelope detector, and it is preferred for the conventional amplitude type of modulated signal only, detection of this kind of a signal only, because the carrier signal is already present into it. The advantage of this detection process is that it is very simple and very cheap. You can say that it is very simple and cheap. Okay, so this is the reason, despite having so many disadvantages, the DSBC or conventional AM type of a signal is used for certain applications like broadcasting, because the detection circuit or the receiver part of the circuit is very cheap in this case. If we are using this conventional AM type of a modulated signal or DSBC type of a signal, the receiver required or the receiver required is very simple and cheap. It is inexpensive type of a receiver. So for all the broadcasting type of applications where a large number of receivers are required, we use DSBC type of or conventional AM type of the modulated signal, despite its inefficiency in power and transmitted power and the bandwidth. It is highly power inefficient and bandwidth inefficient. Still, it is used because it is a cost effective kind of a modulation technique, because the receiver required is very, very inexpensive. Okay. So this is the first type of detection technique that is used broadly for conventional AM type of a signal or DSBC type of a signal. We'll have a look at the other detection techniques in the next lecture. Thank you.